Chris Mann on BBC Radio Cambridgeshire.
So it's Wellbeing Wednesday, the hour on the show every week where we check in on some of the health stories that affect us, meet some of the people involved in them. We've already talked about food and moods and the size of wine glasses and Christmas decorations affecting our well-being. We've also all signed up to give up the booze in January. And do join us. Email me, chris.mann@bbc.co.uk, if you want to join it all. Nikki Peters is our regular Wellbeing Wednesday panellist, and yeah, you're in, aren't you?
Yes.
So that's at least five of us.
Yes.
See how we yes. go. So let's talk now about the Hunt Community Cancer Network charity, which has been doing some great work. We're going to explain it all and find out what happens. It was founded by Susan Moore, who joins us now. Hello, Susan.
Hello.
Just tell us a little bit about you and your story, please.
Yes, I was diagnosed 8 years ago with a blood cancer that's a rare one, myelofibrosis. And Gini was a specialist nurse in haematology at that time, so that was when I met her. She looked after me extremely well, so when she moved over to start a new project, I was really keen to move over with her, and that was really the start of establishing the Hunt's Community Cancer Network.
Okay, and Ginny Melesi is with us. Hello.
Hello.
Who was the lead nurse on that. It was part of a pilot project, lots of them around the area, is that right?
There were seven pilots within the east of England that were funded jointly by the Cancer Network and Macmillan, and that was to look at how they could deliver care better to cancer patients, move more care out of the hospitals, and a big part of that was around survivorship, because it was recognised that patients were getting support through treatment, but at the end of treatment they kind of fell apart, so we kind of had two different focuses, one to get people through treatment. And
okay, what does support mean?
Well, I think there's two different types. So there is the generic support, which people think about as being psychological and having someone to talk to, how dreadful it is that you have cancer. But I guess my angle was much more around the evidence-based, around how you make people take charge of their cancer. So instead of kind of going through your treatment, curling into a ball, stopping work, eating chocolate, and everybody saying, oh, you know, rest up, that's not very helpful. What you need to do is carry on working, carry on taking charge of your life, doing what's important to you, carrying on working, and doing those things that are going to help you get through. So understanding your disease, understanding the treatment, knowing what's good for it, what you can do yourself. So evidence, there's a lot of evidence around exercise. That's a big, big component of what okay. we do.
And Susan, has it helped you?
Oh, yeah. Yes, you don't want to feel like a victim, and you don't want to walk into a room and people see someone with cancer coming in. You want to go in as the person you always were. And for me, I didn't want people to do things to me. It can be really complicated, because you think, okay, I've got a cancer of the blood, but then that affects the liver, that affects the portal, it affects so many other bits of you, and the interaction between the different medications, it's really complex. But I didn't want someone to be doing things to me. I wanted to understand, and I wanted to be making decisions about what I wanted to have done to me.
So how many people has this helped so far, Ginny?
Oh, I always need to look that one up. I mean, hundreds.
In Huntingdon?
Hundreds. I mean, we would have seen around 1,000 patients, but then you have those patients that stay with you. So you see all the patients that at the start of treatment, getting them through the treatment, and then they do go off and get on with their lives. But there's those patients that are far more complex, like Susan, that have ongoing cancers or don't cope with their cancer, that need to stay with you.
And funnily enough, we have someone who slipped through the net here by coincidence. Yeah. You just met them. So Nikki lives in Huntingdon.
Yep.
You had breast cancer.
Yep.
And didn't know about it, or what?
I've heard about it because I had a Macmillan nurse at Hinchinbrook Hospital, which is based in Huntingdon, and I've been to the breast cancer conference there and been part of Hollywood or Bust, which is part of the support group at the hospital. And if I'm honest, I've heard it mentioned when I was at the breast cancer conference, but nobody really explained what it was or anything like that. And which is why I then, because of my plastic surgeon is in Addenbrookes, I was looking for someone. I was looking for support earlier this year, so I'm sort of 15 months post my treatment. I needed some support because I was getting fatigue and different side effects, and my life's changed quite significantly since the cancer, because I was also, my boss decided to get rid of me as well, so that's another story. So my life's changed significantly and I really needed support, and I ended up going to Maggie's Wallace because that was all I knew
so
about.
So what they do would have made a difference to you.
Yeah, and it's exactly as you say, it's about that education around what was happening to me. The fatigue was a big thing. I've now been referred to for fitness, so I now have started that last week to go to the gym and all of that, and I didn't know those things existed. So yeah, it's really important what you're doing. It's I guess it's just still making sure that those loopholes are not being missed.
Well done for being there. Yeah. Obviously it's the right idea.
Absolutely.
But just, we need to make sure that more people know about it, I suppose.
And that's the whole point of trying to be raise awareness. We've been very busy creating a service, but we really realise we need to help the people who can benefit from the service be aware that we're there. There's certainly the NHS knows that we're there and the mechanisms are there for them to refer, but we need people saying, I want this.
And where does this happen? Or do you go to people's homes? What happened? You
know, so we were based
in... Do you meet together as fellow cancer patients? Is that how it happens? Or is it a one-to-one thing?
So the nursing service is based at Hinchinbrook Hospital, and that sees patients whether they're on the ward, they come into A&E, if they're in clinic, and also goes out to see them at home, which is the big part. So we will do treatments at home, blood tests, treatments, keep people out of hospital. The support side of it meets. We have the Holiday Inn in Huntingdon are brilliant. They give us free space there, and there's a support group that meets every week where there's also nurses present. So if there's patients know that they need to find someone to ask a question, they can go along to our Friday morning sessions at the Holiday Inn. That's every week. We also then run the exercise classes, which I'll let Susan talk about because that's a key.
Okay, and I just wanted to mention Rebecca Griffiths, because we can't have this conversation without mentioning Rebecca, who sadly died last year, and talked to her on the programme several times.
Yes.
And she raised many, many thousands.
She did.
She really did. She really helped us.
And awareness too, of course, because
she
was such a campaigner and such a wonderful person.
Absolutely. And her drive for exercise still goes on. I mean, the running group is enormous. It has hundreds of people in it now. So she did an enormous job there, making people aware of the importance of exercise.
I'm really interested in this because it's not something you hear. I can't even remember hearing about it. Cancer patients should exercise. Never heard that before.
There's a growing amount of evidence that it actually affects your recurrence. So it's not only about eating well and doing exercise because it will make you feel good. There's evidence. You know, they've looked at cells of cancer patients who exercise and don't exercise under the microscope, and they can see it makes a difference to do with lots of
just
really
your
technical stuff.
Your
no,
fitness.
It's on a cellular level.
Is it right?
With cytokines and things that are released. It's even too technical for me, but the proof is there. It makes a difference. It does make you feel good. It makes you feel less tired. If you felt tired on a Sunday afternoon because you've had a glass of wine, you think, I really can't be bothered to go out. But you make yourself go out. You come back and you feel so much better. So we know it affects mood. It's social, and social is really great. It boosts your immune system, and it definitely, there is, you know, growing evidence. The NHS is now supporting that everybody, and having exercise at the start, so not at the end when you finish your treatment, but to keep fit from day one to get you through that treatment.
See, I was really fit before I started. I used to go to CrossFit 3 times a week and I was ridiculously fit and ran, and I've lost all my fitness and put on a lot of weight because of it, because I couldn't keep up with the gym because of financial things. And it's only now 18 months, and it's had a huge impact on me physically, but more importantly, it's had a huge impact on me mentally. But like I said, I had to go and find that support sort of 15 months later, which is so frustrating. But
it is frustrating because
the breast care team do know about us, the GPs know about us. So,
but the referral process, people are referred by the nurses as soon as they're ready to exercise, and that can be whilst they're still in treatment. The person who runs the exercise programme for the charity is an ex-oncology nurse. She is a personal trainer. She's trained to cancer level 4. She has all the skills that enable someone who feels, who has lost their confidence and who is worried about their body, to get started again.
If people want to find out more, Ginny, what's the website, please?
Susan?
www.hccn.org.uk.
Okay.
Good on the spot.
Susan Moore, Ginny Melesi, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thanks to Nikki Peters.
Thank you.